Yes, this is ska. Original and indigenous. The music of guitar, saxophone, trumpet, bass, and drums.
One step beyond!
What's up, posers? Welcome to Punkalotto Pod. I'm your co-host, Justin Hensley.
I'm your other co-host, Dylan Hensley.
And this is the show where we choose one year at random and select one punk, hardcore, emo, or punk-adjacent album from that year to discuss. We're in our final week of SKAUGUST, which is our month celebration of ska music. We didn't do a full month. We just did 3 weeks. But, yeah.
Which is a month, right? 3 weeks. Months are 3 weeks long.
Okay.
A month is 3 weeks.
I say if you do a majority of the month, then you've done a month on it. 3 weeks is most of a month.
I think I've always thought a month is 3 weeks. I think since I was a kid, I was just like, yeah, a month is 3 weeks long. And that's just how I've remembered the length of a month. And it's not. It's
3 full weeks and then like a little at the front and a little at the end. Like this.
Yeah.
Mostly four, but some months have five. Yeah. Yeah, but I say 3 full weeks is a pretty average for a month. So, yeah, that's not too bad. Anyway, kind of in our series concept, I don't think we're going to do a series on the next one until we hit October. But I have an idea, and Dylan and I will discuss this. We'll discuss it more at the end of the episode. I have an idea I want to run by you, so we'll see. It won't be a full series thing, but I'm thinking more like a challenge approach. So we'll save it for the end. But yeah, SKAUGUST. Ska is a genre that Dylan and I tend to avoid throughout the year because we're like, we're going to do SKAUGUST. And then some years completely forget to do.
Yeah.
And so I was like, we don't dive too deep on ska, despite it being like maybe one of the first punk subgenres that I like heavily got interested in as a kid. And because swing and ska revival were big in the 90s. And like our dad bought a copy of Let's Face It by the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones in 1997. I bought like the W's was like my first entry into like, it was more like swing revival rockabilly, but also some ska elements too. And then that rolled into being into the Supertones and Five Iron Frenzy. So like ska was definitely one of the earliest subgenres that like I definitely got into. Like I heard punk music on the radio before, but the first time it felt like something that was mine was ska music. So
you said it being one of the first subgenres that we got into in punk, and it just kind of occurred to me, two-tone is kind of like one of the first, what, two punk subgenres? Because it's like post-punk immediately, yeah. And yeah. Two-tone kind of simultaneously. I mean, I guess you could argue that two-tone is more of a subgenre of new wave than it is punk specifically, but so associated with the punk scene.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like one of the first five subgenres. I count new wave as a subgenre of punk. A lot of people don't. I think people are just like, no, it's just pop music. But
I don't really consider new wave a subgenre of punk because I do think of it as being just a subgenre of rock in general.
Yeah.
Because that's really kind of what it was. It was just a new wave of rock. You know, it wasn't prog rock. It wasn't. I don't know. It wasn't hard rock. It wasn't any other kind of rock really at the time. So it was like, hey, we're going to do actual rock music again, which then they like kind of stopped doing actual rock music within that genre. But
yeah, so it's kind of something that we don't hit on a lot because we're saving it for something special. It's the same reason why we don't like do too many like gothic-y stuff, but also I don't love gothic-y stuff that much, so maybe that's really why we don't do too much with it.
Yeah,
that's why we're not doing Misfits records in like June. I guess that's really more what it is, but we'll have to figure out our breakdown for the Halloween theme. It could just be the same thing, just a week of each subgenre. But you can head on over to our Patreon and get access to all of our weekly bonus audio. That's patreon.com/punklottopod. For $1, you get to hear our most recent audio where Dylan and I did an I'm Listening, where we talk about the records we listened to over the last month. You can also hear the first episode of New Release Update, the rebranded New Release Friday. It just means I don't do it on Friday anymore, and I just do it when I want to. So I gave myself a job the first time
around. Putting the word update in the title makes me think of it as a weekend update.
Well, I thought of it more of as the updates on Unsolved Mysteries.
Oh.
Like every time there was an update, they played that music. And I did that. I put the intro is now the MTV News sound, and then it goes update.
So you got to do them in a Norm voice, though, to just tie in the weekend update thing.
Yeah.
All right. This is your new music update.
That sounds more like Al Franken.
Yeah.
Which
Norm's not an easy impression to do.
No, it's very difficult. Yeah, patreon.com. And then also for the $10 tier, you get to choose the album that we discuss on the show. So that's a one-time $10. Here you go. And then we'll say, all right, what do you want to talk about? And then we'll do it. And we've done it a few times. We've got a couple. We've been threatened with a few at this point. And I'm waiting for one of them to pull the trigger. I think they're all pending. They're all waiting just to be like, all right, guys, go ahead and send it now. We're between seasons. So go ahead, send your picks now if you want. So. And then, yeah. So SKAUGUST, how do you feel about this approach to SKAUGUST?
I think it worked.
We started off with the two-tone approach, which I thought was really fun. We'll eventually run out of two-tone bands, but we at least have three more years of two-tone bands to do episodes on.
Yeah, I guess we can always cycle around to their other records.
Maybe do like a reunion record.
Yeah.
See how two-tone stands up in the 2020s.
We've talked about the classic specials records. How about some late specials records?
Yeah, two-tone. And then we did a third wave episode. We covered the Bruce Lee Band and their self-titled album. And we actually got a couple responses. We received a voicemail and a message in the Discord being like, I can't believe you guys haven't seen the Brady Bunch at two-part. There's some conflict on if it's two or three. Mr. Hanale, Vincent Price in Brady Bunch in Hawaii, like episodes.
We did not watch the Brady Bunch. I guess we just didn't have Nick at Night. I don't know. What did they play Brady Bunch on? We didn't have cable, so we weren't watching TV Land.
It would be like randomly on. I remember like watching it in like the middle of the day. So maybe like in the afternoon. So like it was probably syndicated in our area, but it was also like probably a time of day where we weren't really like watching that much TV. I do remember it being on, though, around when the Brady Bunch movie came out.
Yeah.
So honestly, I feel like I've seen the Brady Bunch movie more than I've seen episodes of the Brady Bunch, which in a way, the Brady Bunch movie is kind of a parody of the Brady Bunch.
Yeah.
It's kind of a parody. It's like they put them in the modern age, too. So it's like a little bit of a fish out of water thing. And like the joke in that movie is, why are they so weird?
Yeah.
Whereas I guess in the context of the 70s, they weren't that weird, but yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. We didn't. Anytime I saw it, it didn't do anything for me.
No. It's not a show that like I definitely have a strong affinity for. I definitely loved the Batman TV series from the 60s. That show was great because they showed that all the time. And my dad like taped it off TV every week.
Yeah.
So we had like a VHS full of them. That's my 60s kitsch TV, I guess. Dylan, you like the Monkees. That's like your...
I mean, my wife loves the Monkees. I enjoy some Monkees content. I'm trying to think of the 60s kitschy TV shows that I really like. Get Smart.
Yeah.
I do love Get Smart. That's a great show.
Yeah.
But that's such a different sense of humor. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. I just never saw it. And so there's the movie, too. There's like the Brady Bunch Go to Hawaii movie. Did they just redo the two-parter or three-parter as the movie? I don't know. I never saw that one.
I don't know.
It was like the follow-up. I don't know. Never saw it. I guess it was a big cultural moment because we were also reminded that the President of the United States of America also did a song about that episode with Vincent Price. It's funny.
Oh, and I guess this is an opportunity to talk about the actor who played Mr. Hanale. Lippi Espinda was from Hawaii. He was born in Honolulu. Showed up in Hawaii 5-0, Inferno in Paradise. Did a lot of commercials. I think probably local commercials, but maybe some stuff that had regional broadcasts. And he is, I don't know if he's like fully credited, but at least is like associated with the popularization of the shaka hand signal, which is like the pinky and thumb.
The what's been lately currently nomenclature calls the surf's up.
Yeah, which is like a, I think is a fairly traditional like Hawaiian greeting hand gesture, but he's kind of credited with like popularizing it. But
Roman Reigns does it a lot. And he's Samoan. So, but they also part of his family lived in Hawaii too. So like The Rock lived in Hawaii. So yeah, I could see that being, it could be specifically Hawaiian, but also Samoans borrow from the shaka. Yeah. Yeah. I just thought it was funny that everybody was like, you haven't seen that Brady Bunch? nope. I find the show weird and off-putting.
I don't know. Maybe our parents didn't like it.
A lot of times that happens where it's just like when you're young enough for your parents to be like, let's not watch this.
I don't want to sit through this.
I do remember you mentioned Get Smart. There was like one summer, like I guess it's like TV Land or Nick at Night was like showing like Get Smart like every night for like the week we were at the beach.
Yeah.
And we loved it. We were like, oh, this is so good. It was probably a marathon.
Yeah.
And then I remember our parents being like, all right, we're going to watch something else tonight. We're not going to watch Get Smart every night, all night for a whole week. Like, we're going to watch something else.
This is new content. I've never seen this and I like it. And I know that when we leave here, I'm not going to see it again.
Yeah. I don't know if that's a thing that other people experienced. Non-cable having the beach was like the week that you had access to cable for like a whole week. It was so awesome. It's part of the vacation. And every for a couple years, like our parents still don't have cable. They haven't had cable since I was like in kindergarten. So
why would you have it now?
Oh, now, unless you're watching like sports, you don't need cable now.
Yeah.
So yeah, we did the two-tone, we did our third wave, and now this leaves us with new tone. It's like new Coke, kind of. So,
except without the whole bait and switch.
Okay, so I guess it's a term that does need, I guess, a little bit of explaining on what it is. So, new tone is a term that's been thrown around with a lot of the newer ska bands or the bands who've been closely associated with Bad Time Records. But not everyone is a Bad Time band. The album we're talking about today is not a Bad Time Records band. But a majority of like the Bad Time Records bands are under that new tone umbrella. It's not like an official genre thing. It's more of a just like a thing that makes them stand apart from previous generations of ska. I've seen it called fourth wave ska too. I think new tone has been the mostly accepted term. A lot of the bands who like get called that are pretty open to it, which is a rare thing. A lot of times the bands are like, we don't like that label, like anytime they get tagged with something. But this one, I think there's like a sense of community here that makes it a little bit more unique. So what are the characteristics of new tone? It's essentially still like third wave ska sounding. It's like a mixture of punk and ska music and a little bit of two-tone. And I guess if you want to look at it musically exclusively, there's more inclusion of like other styles of music, like some hardcore music, more some jazzy type stuff. It's a little bit of a wider umbrella other than ska and punk. It like incorporates a lot more stuff.
I think that if we're calling new tone a genre, or, you know, fourth wave ska broadly, because I feel like the new tone, the problem I have maybe at least with the new tone name is that it does sound like it should be primarily bands doing a two-tone style ska just by the tone association, which there is a pretty heavy emphasis on two-tone influences. So I think it can fit for most of the bands that kind of fall into the category. But I think that something that defines fourth wave ska in general is that it is pretty expansive in terms of what gets incorporated. And I mean, I think it's that it's naturally doing much of what third wave did in terms of like taking what's in the water at the time. And so you know, as time has passed and as like a fourth wave has kind of like culminated, we've had the rise and fall of emo popularity and multiple waves of that and different directions that that's gone. And I mean, at this point, we're on like, you know, we're already past the pop punk revival bubble. But
so there is another element to New Tone that I think is what really makes it what it is. So the ska band Bad Operation, they're from New Orleans. The Dominic Minix of the band coined the term New Tone, and he described it as a movement. He said it riffs on the original ska movement of the Britain during the 70s and 80s called Two Tone, as the new generations share its values of political criticism and multiculturalism. So I think the reason why they go with the New Tone instead of just calling it fourth wave ska is that it's specifically trying to bring back the element of breaking down, you know, race barriers. Like the original Two Tone, it was like about being like a mixture of black and white musicians playing together and breaking down racial barriers. And yeah, then applying that today in a black and white and Hispanic and, you know, like all races, throw in like every one's like orientation and gender identities and all, including all of that stuff. And there is also the combination of this is the post pandemic version. It's like a lot of these bands predate the pandemic. Like a lot of them have records that date back to like 2010, 2012. But like the New Tone term is a fairly new term that kind of was like, we're kind of all in this together. Ska took a big hit, but then there was just this new like community working together. Like one of the cool things that actually did come, one of the only positive things in music that I think that COVID did was pushed people together in the scene in a way that they weren't before. And I think all of the ska bands were just like, they're pushed together more now in a way that they're just like, look, we can actually like talk to each other and hang out and online and like do like these pandemic, you know, online shows. And then once the pandemic got to the point where we could like leave our homes again and like tours could resume, then we started getting package tours. Like there was a Bad Time Records tour that just, they did like a Kickstarter to make a documentary in the vein of like the Dance Craze documentary, which was focused on Two Tone. It's called This Is New Tone. And it was based on the tour that happened this summer that they filmed. I guess they filmed the whole thing. And it was Cat Bite, We Are the Union, Kill Lincoln, Bad Operation, Omnigon, Jay Navarro and the Traitors, Jer, and more. And so, like, those are a lot of the big New Tone bands. The Bad Operation record label, pretty much everyone. We Are the Union are probably the, like, the forefront band of that. Because, especially with their, like, newest record, they were, like, the lead singer of the band came out as trans. Jer is non-binary. Like, that became a big emphasis on that band's identity. And so that's another, like, element of the band that element of New Tone that like makes it slightly different from Two Tone. I'm sure like a lot of Two Tone bands were definitely openly, you know, open for gay and trans people at the time, but
yeah, I don't know if the English Beat guys knew that when they appropriated the image of a trans woman for their logo, but
right,
one of the classic icons of, as we mentioned on the first episode in the SKAUGUST season, is a trans woman.
Yeah. And it's also worth mentioning, too, that like the third wave had elements of that, too. And one of the biggest spearheads, though, it was Mike Park and Asian Man Records. Like the Ska Against Racism tour was a thing that he helped put together that was specifically, you know, about raising awareness of like anti-racist causes. And I'd say like, and even like it goes back to like, they're canceled now, but it's really just Dickie's canceled. But like the Boston's were like talked about race a lot in their yeah, history, and you know, about how we need to break down these barriers. And so,
and this is maybe a good opportunity to talk about, as much as there is like, you know, the joke of Christian ska as a genre, Five Iron Frenzy, we've said on the show before, is like one of the most radicalizing bands you and I have ever heard. I mean, they have always had like expressly political and socially conscious lyrics. Even the Mighty Mighty Boston's were pretty or not the Boston's, the OC Supertones. They talked about unity. They had, and they were an interracial group. They had members of other races. Like, they, I think, understood the, you know, like, they certainly would have talked about it in, like, we're all, what's, I guess, the Bible verse of, like, neither Greek nor Gentile or Jew, or, you know, basically that, you know, all Christians are accepted regardless of their identity. But
I do think it's worth mentioning that the 1998 Sky Against Racism tour was Less Than Jake, Mustard Plug, The Toasters, Five Iron Frenzy, MU330, Blue Meanies, Mike Park, and Kimuri. Five Iron were the only Christian band on that, like,
yeah,
that wave. Because, like, Five Iron, the first song on their very first record is about manifest destiny and the Western expansion of the United States and stealing land from Native people. So, like, they've always been on that tip. I guess just that maybe the third wave was, like, the biggest wave of, like, it was the biggest wave of ska. It's probably the most popular wave. And maybe, like, the message of anti-racism wasn't as obvious or as apparent across the genre. Instead, it was just more like certain bands really referenced it a lot. But, and I think that's what makes the new tone sound kind of in that same spirit, and what makes them exciting too. Like, I've never been more excited for new ska music than I have been since the last 5 years or so. Like, there have been so many cool new bands that have come out, or bands that have been out for a long time that I just had never heard before. Because there was that period of, like, the third wave in popularity dies off in the beginning of the 2000s, and it's just like a lot of third wave bands just, like, they stuck together and they kept releasing albums throughout that period, but, like, they weren't impacting
newer bands. And newer bands weren't really even breaking through, I don't think, even too much within the very small ska scene. Like, because We Are the Union, they go back to 2005. They put out an album in 2007. They didn't have their moment until the current wave, you know?
And the Interrupters are probably, like, one of the other ones that, like, is that bridge to the third wave and the new tone. Because, like, they also kind of took off in the 2000s. Big D and the Kids Table started in the 90s, but I feel like they became more relevant in the 2000s. Same with, like, Streetlight Manifesto, like, the, and Bomb the Music Industry, I guess, is the other, like, really big.
Aren't the Interrupters the canceled one?
What did they get canceled for? I haven't heard this.
Aren't they, like, Sandy Hook Truthers?
I don't think so.
JR talked about it, I think.
I have not heard that.
Amy Interrupter. Maybe it gets more complicated. She talked about being assaulted with a crowbar by illegal immigrant thugs at some point.
Hmm.
They I think have, like, a weird sketch thing.
Weird. There's a Reddit thread that says the Interrupters on the far right politics of the Interrupters. Weird. I had no idea. That sucks.
yeah, there's, like, a JR. I guess there's a Ska Tune Network clip where JR talks about it, but I don't think it's available anymore. Which, there's someone in this Reddit thread saying that there's a line where they say Hellcat Records has the money to scrub the internet clean.
Amy Interrupter directly worked with people at the origins of the neo-fascism, like Alex Jones and Ron Paul. Here's a video of her at the Ron Paul Revolution. And oh, okay. Weird. I had no idea. They just were vaguely libertarian, twerpy libertarian punks, as someone described it. But then they, yeah. Weird. Strange. Did not know that about the Interrupters. Yikes. They were important, I guess, at one point.
Is it? No, they're not in the COVID truth. Nobody from the Interrupters is in the COVID.
No, that's Dickie, right?
That's just Dickie, yeah. Yeah.
Well, they were friends of the Boston's, so that might actually make a little more sense. Huh. Well, learn something new. Yeah, I didn't know about them.
Yeah, it also makes Hellcat look even ickier.
Yeah. Yeah.
People don't talk about that stuff. Anyway, we don't want to get cease and desisted by Hellcat, so we're going to stop here.
DM us later. We'll tell you all about it.
You probably know.
Yeah, you're probably aware of it. Nobody, I just forgot.
And everybody else just never did the math on that one.
So yeah, the new tone bands, the bands that I think make up this style, there are some fun, like, playlists. There's, like, one that's been updated, like, every year for, like, 3 years now, called just New Tone Ska, and whatever year it is, and they just put, like, new ska bands. So for the 2023 one, this includes bands like Poindexter, Bad Operation, Half Past Two, The Eichlers, Jay Navarro and the Traitors. Jay Navarro is from Suicide Machines, but he's been pretty active as a solo musician, or his current band. Omnigon, which is also like a Link 80 related band. That's happening too. There's like the third wave people who are still making new music. Like Mustard Plug has a new record coming out this year. They're not necessarily considered new tone, but I think they're on Bad Times Records, and they're probably going to take out some of these bands on tour. You know, like Omnigon has done work with other people in the new tone, like the Bruce Lee band has incorporated some members, like Cat Bite, I think, and Mike Parks at least worked with some of them. I think he wrote a song for Cat Bite, even. We have Devin Kay and The Solution. We Are the Union, probably the big forefront band. And then Jer and Ska Tune Network. But there's other bands, like I considered doing, like choosing like Gray Matter. Yes, but spelled different from the other Gray Matter. or like a Kill Lincoln record. We've done Cat Bite on the show before. So yeah, a lot of newer bands, really, but a lot of these bands have been around for a while. But yeah, it's just a newfound kind of term and umbrella. So wanted to define kind of what new tone was in case anyone was unfamiliar with what it meant. Because I did see a thread on Reddit because I was looking up like the origins of new tone, and somebody was like, it just means new ska bands. And then like someone in the comments was like, it's not just new ones. It's like a and then got into the message part of it.
Yeah.
It's just a pretty pointless term is what the person was saying. And they're like, no, there's a reason why these things happen the way they do.
But I don't think even if there wasn't like a specific like social consciousness angle to it, I think there is something that it does feel pretty definitive of new tone is that there is an emphasis on like there's an incorporation of a lot of other things that are have happened in music in the last two decades that we haven't had like a proper new wave of ska. There's also like a reorientation towards the traditional ska rhythm in a way that third wave ska kind of like as it progressed and especially up into and around its like its peak in popularity where it was like punk with horns. I do think that consistently most of the newer ska bands are like really locked into that skanking rhythm, like that guitar style, those rhythmic elements.
I think too that even a lot of like the third wave people who've come back have also started to incorporate more of that too. Like the newest Five Iron Frenzy record is the most traditional ska they have ever sounded. And who else did? Like Dan P did like an entire like two tone style record a few years ago, and even his solo records have like more traditional two tone and original ska rhythms to them. So it is a little bit of a like, I think punk with horns feels more dated, whereas the more like traditional rooted ska sounds are a little bit more timeless. And I think that's why so many of those bands are like, let's do more like that. You know, that's why we like ska in the first place, you know?
Yeah.
So before we get into the album I actually selected, we thought we'd take a second just to look and see at what the rest of the year looked like. So the album we're talking about today came out in 2021. And just out of curiosity, we were like, what else was going on besides, you know, new tone stuff? Because like no music is released in a vacuum. So like we're kind of like seeing what the umbrella of punk music in 2021 was way, way back, a whole 2 years ago.
Yeah. Looking at this list, it's been 2 years already. It's Glow On. It's
Turnstile.
There's
the Taco Bell band now.
Yeah. There's like a record from like all of the Marky Smiths. There's a Shame record, a Viagra Boys record, an Idols record, and an Ice Age record. There's somebody else. There's another one of those big bands.
New Country Black Road, I guess. Would you put them in there?
No, that's like a post-rock record. I don't know. Maybe there's somebody else that's a little more obscure, but those are the big ones. There's some of that Australian stuff, too. Some Amel. Say there was another one. Tropical Fuckstorm had that record as well.
It's funny. I haven't really looked at 2021 on this website in a minute. So I was kind of curious to see what kind of stood the test of time, or like wound up getting like votes and stuff. And it's a lot of stuff that I, yeah, sure, I expected that. Surprised to see Slant and their album on here, and the Pompoko record. Like, oh, okay, these are still high. And even that Trico record that I'm like, did anybody care about that one? But apparently they did. And then, you know, Every Time I Die is Radical, Willow Smith's album lately, I Feel Everything, Illuminati Hotties, Portrayal of Guilt, like some of the bands who are still like pretty popular right now. I mean, it's not even been a full 2 years, so it would stand reason that they are still popular bands.
That Fiddlehead record's a Page Two record.
They have a new one coming out this year too.
Yeah, which curious to see what impact that one has. That Fiddlehead record was pretty big.
Yeah. The first one was really big. The second one was still big, but I think the first one was bigger. Yeah, it's the kind of stuff where you're like, oh, that was 2 years ago? Like, I'm just like, I feel like that was just last year that this came out. But
yeah, it's I think generally speaking, most of what's on here, pretty much all of what's on here is kind of it's the current wave of one of these subgenres. Like, what's on here from 2 years ago is still more or less what those subgenres are doing right now. It's those bands, it's those sounds.
To keep it ska, it is worth mentioning Ska Dream by Jeff Rosenstock, Nice One by Catbite, Ordinary Life by We Are the Union, Ooh, When God Was Great by the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones. Ooh,
yikes.
That's the last one.
Yeah.
Until This Shakes Apart by Fire of Iron Frenzy, The Best and the Worst by Better Medicine, Joystick, I Can't Take It Anymore. I thought about choosing that one. Big D, Voodoo Glow Skulls, Ska 2 Network, couple Ska 2 Networks. Jared cranks those out. Abracadabra, Make Yourself at Home. They're a Brazilian ska band. The Shape of Ska Punk to Come, Volume 2 by Bad Operator. Bad Time Records. Yeah, so New Tone. We're firmly in New Tone territory still. So let's get into the actual record then. So I was like, okay, what do I want to do? I could do that. I could do a Kill Lincoln record. I could do a We Are the Union record. I could do that Grey Matter album, which would have been cool because there's a lot of jazz on that record. I could have done, we've done Catbite already. Yeah, there was options. I have plenty of options to choose from. And I went with the band that I think is probably my favorite out of all of them. And I selected Flying Raccoon Suit and their album Afterglow. On the band, they're from Biloxi, Mississippi. They just say Mississippi though on their Bandcamp, but I read an interview that specifically said Biloxi. This was a self-released album, came out March 19th, 2021, and the person on this album is Jessica Jeanson on vocals and melodica, Andrew Heaton on guitar, vocals and trombone, Derek Curley on drums, keys and vocals, Joshua Billiott on bass, Guillermo Gibson on tenor sax, Nevin Applewhite on alto sax, and Brandon Kenyon on cornet. Recorded and mixed by Derek Curley. the drummer of the band. Also worth mentioning, Andrew Heaton also plays in the band Joystick. And this is the band's third full-length album, at least according to Bandcamp. Their 2012 album, Paper Airplanes, which I think was when they were in high school. And their 2016 album, Flying Raccoon Suit Needs a Friend. And yeah, so do you have any connection to this band whatsoever? Did you know anything by them at all?
No. I don't think I've listened to anything they did. I know you've talked about them. I just haven't listened.
So yeah, I found them that year, 2021. I think it was this album. I either saw like a song, maybe it was something like, oh, here's a new song by this band. Maybe it was like the alternative. Maybe threw it on the playlist or something like that. And I was like, hey, a new ska band. That's interesting. Let's see what they sound like. And I liked the song. And so then I threw the record on my list to check out. And yeah, when the album came out, I was like, I really like this. I really like what they're doing here. They do it. They do their version of ska a little bit different than a lot of the other bands. Like, We Are the Union, you know, have been around forever. So they kind of sonically are very much in that third wave sound. They have updated their sound a bit to match the like post Jeff Rosenstock world of ska that now exists. And then like Kill Lincoln is like a punkier band. And like I said, Grey Matter was more like jazzy, and Abracadabra is pretty skate punky. Yeah. So like nobody is like super different. Like as far as like, you're not doing anything completely off of what ska music has been in the past. And I feel like Flying Raccoon Suit actually do kind of do some different stuff. And yeah, so they've always been in my head. Them and Cat Bite are like my number one, number two of the current wave of ska bands that I really like. And so I was definitely eager to listen to this album again and revisit it and, you know, kind of think, listen to it with like a critical ear. So I guess it's very new to you. What did you think of this record?
I enjoyed it. I think that of the new tone bands I've heard, yeah, they do kind of stand in their own category. I think that they maybe have the most expansive sound. I think they maybe incorporate the broadest range of what most of the new tone bands are doing. Because like Cat Bite is very like two tone, like very rooted in a pretty traditional sound. We Are the Union is a bit more third wave, you know, is pretty consistent in like a kind of a pop punk ska sound. And even like the other ones that I've heard, like Kill Lincoln, they're pretty uniform in their sound, like song to song. They're not doing anything too wildly different, which I think that's mostly true of most of the other new ska bands, is that from song to song, they're doing kind of the same thing. And I think that what Flying Raccoon Suit does on this record is every song is kind of an opportunity to explore other genres through ska. That kind of seems to be their formula. How do they interpret different things? They do songs that sound kind of like emo. They do songs that sound kind of like, I mean, they do some stuff that's like full on hardcore even. They have pretty straightforward ska songs, but then there's even like, there's kind of a swing influence on a lot of these songs. It's more in the melodies than it is like, you know, in the chord progressions than it is like, they're not like that, 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 you know, they're not, yeah. They're not doing the shtick. There's a swing influence in like a Duke Ellington, you know, compositional influence rather than like a, you know, they're doing a Cab Calloway bit.
Yeah, there's a list that I saw. It was an interview or it was a review that kind of like named everything that they do on this record style wise. I think, yeah, they do stand completely on their own in so much as they are fiercely DIY. They, you know, the drummer recorded the record. They self-released it. They did a Kickstarter for the vinyl for it that they did themselves. You know, they were like, the album's coming out regardless. It's just if we want vinyl to happen, we have to do a Kickstarter for it, which is fine. They're not, you know, they're not a Bad Time Records band. They've played with a lot of those bands, but they're not on the label. They're just like, and it's not like they couldn't be, because like they're from Mississippi. There's a lot of like New Orleans, like Bad Operations from New Orleans right now, and like there's some other ones that I think are from New Orleans too, and like We Are the Unions from Florida, so like the connections are there. Like they very easily could just like go hang out, but they do other things. They do other things too. Like there's an 8-bit version of this entire album, like a chiptune version of the whole record, and then they did a follow up called Afterthought, I believe, which is like reimaginings of their earlier songs. There's like they did like 3 of the songs on here off this record reimagined. So like there's just this, which I guess Cat Bite does the same thing. They did like the Cat Fight and the country record, the hardcore record. So like Cat Bite does the same thing as far as like trying other stuff. But yeah, they incorporate, still trying to, here we go. This was on the Brooklyn Vegan article. But it says, ska is a driving force on Afterglow, but there's so much more than that, including elements of punk, metal, hardcore, jazz, indie rock, and more. I saw one that was like, maybe not even this article, but it was like klezmer, Dixie, like there's all sorts of things on here.
Yeah.
So the record starts off with the title track, and already, like, to me, that's where I'm just like, oh, this is different. It's like double kick, like almost like a metalcore record intro.
Yeah, the drumming is surprisingly heavy throughout the record.
Yeah. It's like a post-hardcore song. Like it feels like part Paramore, part like local metalcore band opening up. Like it was just a very unique way of like kicking off a ska record with just this like big metallic sounding record. And that being said, the drummer, he started playing in metal bands before he ever heard ska. I think he says that he didn't learn about ska until Flying Raccoon Suit was a thing already, because the band formed in high school, and so a lot of them were friends from school. And so I was surprised too, because Jessica, the lead singer, she said that her introduction to ska was Spiderwebs by No Doubt, Tragic Kingdom. And I guess that was like one of the first ska songs she ever heard. And I think that was a pretty big, and Just a Girl, anyway, that was a pretty big entry point for a lot of people in ska. And then she later got into like AMU 330 and Slapstick. And then Andrew, he's the guitar player. He said that he was 12 and he got a Warped Tour DVD and it had a Mad Caddies performance on it. And he said one of my favorite things about ska is the juxtaposition a lot of bands can have with upbeat music having lyrical substance or something more beneath the surface. And how he liked how Mad Caddies had a musical freedom to do whatever they want. To me, Mad Caddies are terrible and I don't like them at all, but they do a lot of different things in their sound to their detriment. I think they just don't do anything well. I would say like the Aquabats are probably a better example of a band that like does lots of different sounds in ska. They also stopped being a ska band at one point, but yeah, the opening track's pretty heavy, and then it goes into Hive Mind, which is like a more like straight ahead song. But even then, it's got these really big drums on it. The melodica makes its appearance here. Really big horns, punky riffs. It's sung by the other guy in the band, not just Jessica, which is a unique. They don't do like they do a lot of kind of like inter singing, some gang vocals as well, but like they kind of like take turns singing. It's not like this song's this one person's song. Like they sing a lot together and they alternate throughout the songs, so that's fun. Then you hit Driftwood and Bleed Me Dry, and this is when like here's the third wave ska. Here's where these songs kind of come in, track 3 and 4. And I feel like this record, it kind of comes in like it's like pairs of songs. That's kind of how I feel. You have like the first two songs are like you're heavier, then you get two like more traditional, then you do Rebirth and Canary in a Coal Mine, which those were like the two most like theatrical and jazzy sounding songs on here, and swingy.
Yeah. the Mississippi thing kind of makes the swingier element make some sense, a little more sense. I think it feels more natural. It doesn't feel like they were trying to be a swing band because it was trendy or anything, which, you know, no one would try to do swing now.
Yeah.
You know,
that well is poisoned.
That is such. Yeah, that is so immediately going to be received as a joke, which is fine, because if you want to actually draw on swing as an influence, like, you can do it. Like, you can do it now, because as long as you're not like doing the whole bit, like, you take the influence, you don't do the costume.
Yeah, swing revival was like, you're right, it was a costume, because they were like, swing dancing was a thing, and like the hats and the suits and everything was like a thing. It was just like, what are we doing? Why are we like reverting to the 50s here?
Not even the 50s,
the 40s.
Confused about decades, really. 50s cars, but like 40s music and costumes, and but also like, yeah, some 50s clothes. It was, they didn't know. Some 60s stuff too. Very, very, very confused. The swingiest aspects of this record are still very buried. Like, it's not, nothing felt like a full on swing song to me, but you can hear it. You can kind of tell it's there. And I think that's some of the like more interesting stuff on the record. So like, I'm glad that it's there. Like, I'm glad that they're drawing on that influence and using it the way that they are, because I think that that's something that they're really good at. And I think that it lends itself to the more, they have a kind of, there's a kind of grandiosity that gives them an emotional weight that I don't, that's kind of like surprising in ska. And to me, like, what I associate it most with is Five Iron Frenzy. Like, they do some stuff on this record that to me feels like some of those really big soaring Five Iron Frenzy songs.
I'm glad you said that, because I feel it. You really get that in the horn arrangements.
Yeah.
To me, like, listening to this record, I was like, this is very Five Iron Frenzy, like, horn arrangement. Is it because there's so many different horns on the record? What did we say that was all on here? We have a melodica. We have trombone, tenor sax, alto sax, and cornet. We're missing a trumpet.
But cornet is...
I mean, yeah, I guess that could be the kind of taking the spot of that. And that's what Five Iron was. Were they a four-horn piece band? There's Dennis, Jeff, Brad, Keith is on bass. I feel like there are four horns in Five Iron Frenzy. Two saxes? Or maybe just one sax that has a trombone and a trumpet. I don't know. For some reason, well, most of the third wave ska bands they all played sax, like most of them, or they only had a sax player. Unless you're like the Boston's, who had like a full ass orchestra up there, you know. But
I think trumpets and trombones are pretty rare. I think that a saxophone of the brass instruments, well, I mean, it's a woodwind technically. I mean, it's a reed. But it's the instrument that if you're going to take a band instrument and keep playing it past band, saxophone is probably the one. It's got probably the most melodic potential, trumpet being like the next, like, because it can be played very melodically. And then trombone is just so unwieldy. and also its register kind of like puts it in a rhythmic capacity. Not a lot of, unless you're like trombone shorty. Not many people are playing lead trombone. You know, Jer is like the most notable like lead trombonist that I can think of. But sax is probably like, yeah, you can do a lot with a saxophone, and you're more likely to do that.
I guess too, it's not so much, I guess, which instruments were chosen to be played, but like the arrangement was really good. It was just like, some ska bands are kind of squeaky with their horns, or just like they're peppery with them, the way they're like burp, 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 you know, like doing like short little bursts. And like this record, like they're doing like longer notes and like extended kind of like, yeah, the way Five Iron did, like just these really like soaring elements to their horn playing.
They're very well arranged. It's a substantial horn section in a ska band. There are the cornet and saxophone get kind of the more jazzy solo stuff too, and that stuff reminds me, particularly the sax reminds me a lot of the MU330. And there's also the whole energy level and of the more aggressive stuff definitely fits within the psycho ska MU330, predecessor to what's his name, Rosenstock. Because he's very much been doing MU330 for most of his career.
He even made Dan Pius his part of his band.
Yeah,
to me, the instrumentation on this record is really the standout. Like, I just like how good everything sounds together on here. Like, all the horns working together, the really big guitars on this record, the bass work is fun. Like, it's not as pronounced, but that's one of the coolest things about ska, is that you can just be like, I'm going to pick an instrument and listen to what they're doing. And almost every instrument is doing something unique. Like the bass, I guess the way guitar works in ska with the upstrokes and stuff like that, that's not really carrying the melody nearly as much. Whereas the bass is actually kind of carrying the notes, I guess, is more what it is.
Well, the bass, I think that bass playing is so interesting in ska. The bass playing has the room to do a lot more. It has the opportunity to play counterpoint. It can maybe not be the lead melody, but it does get to do things in contrast to the chord progression and can support the melody, or can kind of play against the melody. You know, that when you have full on chunky guitars, you don't necessarily have room for that to do. So with the guitars just being strictly carrying the chords and just sticking to just the chords and leaving a lot of space, you get a lot more opportunity to do fun things.
Yeah, we mentioned the drumming just being really good, really interesting, and definitely just that's metal drums. Metal drums in ska is very special, different, not something you see very often. But I don't know, having a drummer kind of be your producer, recording engineer, I think is typically a good idea. I mean, I guess it depends on the drummer. Some drummers are just nope, I just hit the drums, you know.
Yeah, drummers are either super technical and are basically a recording engineers, or they're I've never taken a lesson, I don't know what to do with a microphone.
yeah, it's the extremes. Yeah. But if you've got a really good technical drummer, that means they might actually be able to, they might know a thing or two about recording, maybe.
But every drummer knows exactly how they want the drums to sound.
Yeah. It's funny that drummers are oh, it has to sound like this. It's got to be just right. But every bass player is I don't know, this kind of works, right?
I'm just direct in, right?
Yeah. I guess behind the drummer, it's the vocalist who's the pickiest. No. Let's do that again. But yeah, I think it just really works having this drummer really kind of produce their sound in general. And it makes them really stand apart. They don't feel as much of a punk band as most of the other ones do. Definitely feels more metal and hardcore as influence. Though even emo, what's the song on here that's this is an emo song? Static Home?
Yeah.
I was this is an emo song. It's pretty mellow. Oh, I did really like that everyone else starts with Welcome to Paradise, Green Day riff. Yeah, I just think, they feel unique amongst the wave of new tone bands.
Yeah, Toss and Turn is another one that's pretty emo, the last song.
Yeah. It's got it's a building song, yeah.
It reminds me of a Rainer Maria or that kind of wave of Midwest emo.
Yeah. Also, the way that their voices work together kind of reminded me of the band Aficionado. I don't know if you remembered how they sounded together.
I can see that. And it does lend itself to the theatricality. That's actually also the aggressiveness, too, because Aficionado is weirdly hard.
Yeah.
for being like a an anniversary style yeah. band.
Yeah, I thought the way their voices interplayed together is really what made me think of that. And you're right, there is like heaviness to their records too. So yeah, that's funny.
A lot of the genre blending and the kind of the melodicism and reminds me too of the Sonderbombs.
Oh yeah, yeah.
In the way that that band would be really poppy, but then it's also like, you know, super heavy mosh part.
So it's a well-regarded record. Brooklyn Vegan included it on their 20 Great Ska Albums of 2021. I mean,
that's like, there's all like 20.
There's like 20 good, yeah. It's funny that they're like 20 Best Albums, Ska Albums of 2021. It's like, that's most of them. I mean, I guess there's a lot of not good ones that didn't make the cut, but I think they went alphabetical too. So you couldn't even be like number 3 or something like that. I think it should have been really high up there though. And then from that review, it says, Flying Raccoon Suit have releases dating back to 2012, but Afterglow feels like their grand introduction. It solidifies FRS as one of the most inventive bands in the current ska scene, mixing ska with punk, metal, hardcore, indie rock, jazz, surf rock, klezmer, and more. And with two lead singers, Jessica Jinson and Andrew Heaton, they cover almost as much musical ground vocally as they do instrumentally. Even with all that going on, Flying Raccoon Suit never bite off more than they can chew, and they always come out with catchy, accessible songs. Sometimes they sound like they could have been the biggest band in 1997 with Red Herring, but more often than not, they're pushing ska forward, proving that the genre still has so much more to say. There's even a song on here where like there's like literal like metal vocals, like or hardcore vocals, which I thought, what song was that? That is
towards the end, right? I think they do it a couple. There's some growls.
Bleed Me Dry. That's the song that it happens on. And then New Noise actually reviewed this album too, which was fun. And they said their fearlessness to defy previous waves of ska and push this way forward is apparent from the first 15 seconds of the album. Is it double bass metalcore to 30 seconds in or a deep felt call for wellness? By 45 seconds, the answer is yes. In Flying Raccoon Suit's carbon life form, they provide the tools in their songs to navigate a terrestrial reality. It's a long path through this existence in our somewhat unstable and negative world, and people are searching to overcome without a controller or a joystick. FRS may not be Tanuki Mario in an 8-bit adventure, smashing boxes, looking for wealth. They're not using their horns to rearrange the table of ska either. There was like a theme to this review. they went with like a computery, robot-y sort of theme to the review. The last paragraph, they have found a formula to make complicated emotions feel valuable, universal, and simple. They're searching for wellness and mindfulness by making some great music like the single Hive Mind. It's not earth science or computer programming. They get the heart of this fully analog life, and that's leveling up, too. They really went with the video game angle on the review. Yeah. Lyrically, too, the album is a lot about mental health and wellness and like struggles. Jessica sings about that a lot on this record. Funnily enough, a lot of the songs are written pre-pandemic, so like it was just something that she was like writing about. And then the, you know, none of us have ever like fully mentally recovered from the pandemic. Like as a society, we're not like we haven't dealt with it properly. And so I think there's just something to be said that this came out in 2021, like in the middle of it. Like this is when 2021 was like people were getting vaccines finally. Yeah, because I think I got mine in like February that year. And so it was like some relief was coming, but like it was still going to be a long haul. And then shows then eventually started happening a lot more in the year after. So it's like it's even though the album wasn't about the pandemic, it really like fit the tone and the mood of what, you know, was going on with everyone at that time. And then them being able to come out and like play with other bands and do these like tours and shows and playing fest and stuff like that. It's all been, you know, therapeutic for so many people and bands. And but yeah, I really like this album. I really like this band. I'm very curious what they're going to do next. They really haven't followed this up yet. They've done like they appear on. There's an MU330 like tribute compilation. They covered Tell Another One, which is a really good song. And then they're also on the Operation Ivy compilation that came out this year. And then they did the Afterthought EP with some reimaginings. And so I'm really looking forward to seeing what they do next. I don't know what their plans are. They're still a band. They're still playing shows. They're playing Fest this year. So yeah, I'm hoping we get to hear something soon from them. I'd like to hear what they plan to do next. I'd be curious to see if they keep it like still DIY and self-released, or if I could see them getting scooped up by Bad Time pretty easily.
Yeah, I guess it's the question of what does a label offer? Because they seem to be capable of doing it themselves.
Yeah.
So it's really just how much more reach can a label get them? Is that something they want to even do? Do they want to expand past just putting out records and playing shows when they want to?
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's still like the little bit of the like marketing aspect, maybe just like the putting it out on vinyl for them so they don't have to crowdfund it. Like that could be the thing. Do people prefer crowdfunding? I don't know. Crowdfunding also usually has such a long like wait period.
Yeah. Unless you're using it to recoup what you paid in advance to do it.
Yeah. So maybe like a label has the like the upfront money. That would be the difference. They can wait until it actually comes out to recoup, you know. And I guess there's like the marketing, you know, they could be part of these like Bad Times package deals, you know, which would be fun. But I think they could still easily just be thrown on those tours too. So I don't know. I don't know what they broke out in 2021 without, you know, without a label. So maybe they don't need one. We'll see. But I hope we get to hear more music from them soon, though. I think they're one of the best ones doing it. Well, I think that will conclude our SKAUGUST, right? I mean, there's still like another week in August, but whatever.
Yeah, it's been a fun one. I think it's been a this formula has worked to get to explore the genre across time periods, different time periods of it.
Yeah. So I teased it at the top of the show. I guess instead of doing like a full season approach for the next like one or two episodes, because I know what we want to do for the 250th episode, and it's silly. But I thought like, well, you know, until we get there, we have a few weeks. So we could do a challenge. And instead of doing maybe like a whole like 3-episode arc, but maybe just do like a 1 and a 2. Like we each try and complete the challenge. So I actually have a list of ideas. But I think what we should do is here's the challenge and then just choose a year at random. Literally like number generator randomly selected year. And then you have to pick an album that fits the challenge. What do you think about that?
Sure.
Okay. So the challenge is, we'll start easy with these. You have to pick a debut album. Could be any debut album from a year. So let's see. Let's do this number generator on air. 1976 is our starting year to 2023. 1989. Are you up for the challenge?
Well, I'm already doing that year, so sure.
Find... Your challenge is to find a debut album from 1989 for us to talk about. So once you make your selection, I'll send it in the old group message on the Patreon. So if you're a patron, you get to see what the upcoming episodes are all about. So another little added little bonus. I do these weekly message blasts to everyone, just letting them know what's going on with the show. So, all right, everyone, thank you so much for listening. You can follow us on all forms of social media. We're on Instagram. We're on Twitter. We're on Facebook. We're on Blue Sky and Threads. Dylan got his invite this week for Blue Sky. early thoughts on Blue Sky.
We just need one of these to take off. They're the same. I mean, this one seems to have the functionality that we expect of a Twitter. People just need to use it.
Yeah. I think more people would have already been on Blue Sky by now if it wasn't in like beta form and you could only get on with invites. Because it does, like you said, it has the more functionality that Threads has. Like, you can search for things. That's like the number one thing. And it's chronological. The problem with Twitter now is just like the sheer amount of bots. I've had so many new follows in the last couple of weeks, and every single one of them is a bot. It's awful. Like, it's literally just breaking. The search function is now useless on Twitter. It's losing what it was. There's just still more people on it, and that's why the only thing that keeps it above the others. But yeah, we're all on Punk Lotta Pod at all of those. PunkLottaPod@gmail.com. And our voicemail line, 202-688-PUNK. Love it if everyone would utilize that more. We get a few every once in a while, but they're really... I love hearing from everyone, so... That'll do it, and we will see you next week.
To order Punk, call the number on your screen. Rush delivery is available. Remember, this special offer is not sold in stores.